that is coming to you in association with Bombay Spine Society and faculty from Bombay Spine Society in association with INTAS and Ortho TV. The problems of biopsy in spinal tuberculosis, when to do, when not to do. In India, is biopsy the only way to diagnose spinal tuberculosis? Is there any role of empirical AKT? If yes, how? If biopsy turns negative, what to do then? If a patient is not responding, when do we call someone a non-responder while patient is taking AKT? When do we operate upon? Is neurological deficit the only indication of surgery, or mechanical instability has become an extended indication of fusion in spinal tuberculosis? When do we suspect MDR? How do we diagnose MDR? If we take a sample from a patient in biopsy, how do we process it? What are the requests that are bare minimum to be asked for to get a good culture histopath and diagnosis of MDR versus tuberculosis versus any other pathology? And much more, and many more dilemmas if surgery, anterior versus posterior. When to do posterior, and when is anterior absolutely mandatory? None other than the faculty from Bombay Spine Society to answer all these in the webinar, INTAS Final Verdict Bombay Spine Society webinar. May I call Dr. Amit Jain from INTAS to deliver the welcome address and introduce the session. Dr. Amit Jain.
Thank you so much, sir. Very good evening, all the esteemed delegates and the faculty members. As sir has already shared with all of us that yes, tuberculosis is a problem when it comes to India. And we here in India, we contribute more than 25% of total cases across the globe. And of course, most of the times the tuberculosis is only respiratory or just confined to the pulmonary system. But yes, when it comes to specific systems like bones, and that too, when it comes to spine. So as Dr. Vishal told, managing, not only managing, but starting from diagnosis up till final management, there are multiple doubts in the minds of the people who are responsible for managing it very nicely. So yes, to just go through and just to clear all these doubts, we need to update our knowledge, and definitely we need a wonderful faculty as well as discussion among ourselves to update ourselves with how to manage tubercular spine. So with this background, I, Dr. Amit Jain from Department of Medical Affairs from INARA Division of INTAS, welcome all of you in this second version of final verdict webinar. Today's topic is A to Z Diagnostic Dilemma, Medical and Surgical Management for Spinal Tuberculosis. And this event is being organized under the aegis of Bombay Spine Society, the Final Verdict Webinar. So without taking much of your time, let me hand over the session to our beloved Dr. Abhay Nene, sir. Over to you, sir.
Dr. Abhay Nene.
Thank you so much. And it's exciting for the Bombay Spine Society to come out with a seminar like this, which is called the Final Verdict, because it addresses the most controversial issues. And we are at the helm of affairs, seeing so many patients with such a diverse team of doctors, as a part of the Bombay Spine Society, that we feel it the onus is on us to actually deliver this final verdict. And when we title it, so remember, we do it responsibly. So we have a star faculty along with our two star moderators. We have Dr. Srivastav, Dr. Dalvi, Dr. Vishal Kundani, Dr. Manish Kothari, Dr. Amit Sharma, Dr. Agnivesh Tikku and Dr. Abhijit Pawar amongst us to take part in the deliberations. Apart from that, we also have a big star lineup, including Dr. Mihir Bapat, Dr. S.K. Srivastav. Everyone's along with us. So without much ado, I must introduce to you the two moderators who are going to actually take charge of the proceedings and actually wind us through this big, dense jungle of spinal tuberculosis. The very, very talented Dr. Satyen Mehta, and the young, dynamic, effervescent, always available Dr. Uday Pawar. Over to you, sirs.
Thank you, Dr. Nene, for introducing the session and introducing the moderators. While Satyen and Uday come up with their slides, may I request the president of Bombay Spine Society to please welcome the delegates around from Bombay Spine Society. Dr. Srivastav, sir.
Thank you, Vishal. A very good evening to all the BSS members and all the members who are and the participants who are viewing this program from the different channels. Now, our dynamic secretary, Dr. Vishal, has chosen a very important topic, and that is final verdict in TB. Now, as we understand, this final verdict is today on 8th November 2020. As we know, the bacteria is mutating daily. So maybe next year you will find another final verdict that is of 21. So this bacteria is notorious, and that is the reason, we have this MDR, XDR, and TDR. And this problem is not going to be solved in 1 or 2 hours' time. but we have very vibrant faculties which are going to solve your all queries and how to go ahead with this etiology. Now, I hand over the proceeding to our moderator, Dr. Satyan Mehta and Dr. Uday Pawar. Satyan, please, you can take over.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So we'll jump straight into the cases. Now, this we're talking about this patient who is a 28-year-old female. She's got back pain since the last 3 months, and she has got a lot of loss of weight and some appetite loss as well. Neurologically, she is normal. She's come into the OPD, and this is what she has come with. Now, take a minute to have a look. And Manish, I wanted you to tell me what you see on the MRI and what your diagnosis is.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. So this looks like so D11, 10, 9, 8, 7. Hello?
There is a
lesion going on from 7 to 9. Multiple disc spaces are involved. At some places, the disc spaces are kind of preserved. At other places, they are involved and collapsed disc. There's a large collection in the anterior prevertebral region. I cannot appreciate anything much in the epidural canal. So clearly there is some form of infective lesion going on. Primary, I say that my suspicion is high because the disc spaces are involved multiply. Whether it is TB or not is remains a question.
Abhijit, do you agree with all of this? Do you think it is TB or do you think it could be something else here?
No, as of now, we do not know whether this is TB or not. But there is an there is a collection, there is an abscess, and we need to know more about this this problem with an axial view and also with possibly a biopsy.
So, how will an axial view help you here?
No, I don't see any compression here in this sagittal view, but I would like to know more about this problem. How is the spread of this abscess?
So, this is the axial view.
Right. So in the axial view, you don't see any neural compression there, but there is a large abscess in the right and left paraspinal region, more on the left side. So the now, if I plan to do a biopsy, I would prefer the left-sided pedicle to access this abscess.
Okay. Do you want to straight away go ahead and do a biopsy of this patient?
Yeah, she has back pain. She has abscess. Now I need to have a diagnosis. So next step would be a biopsy.
Before you go ahead for the biopsy, do you have anything in mind? What could this be? Doesn't it look just like a TB case?
No, there are some disc space involvement, but we cannot. I cannot be sure that this is tuberculosis. So till the time I have a biopsy, this could be some other bacteria as well.
Ready to connect.
Amit, you want to come in?
Yes, Satyan.
So, in this patient, would you straight away go for biopsy or would you like to get some investigations done first?
I mean, other than our routine investigations like CBC, ESR and CRP, the basic investigation, I would probably be straight away jumping into the biopsy. This is definitely, looks like that there is a big abscess anterior to the in the prevertebral space. So, to diagnose it, I think biopsy will be the first line of investigation in my hand also.
Okay. You wouldn't want to get any blood investigation before your biopsy?
Other than our routine investigation like CBC and like ESR, CRP, just to keep an eye on the level of infection and inflammation, I think I'll decide about rest of the treatment only after the and any what other investigation is required based on my biopsy.
Satyan wants to carry home the point is that many people do some TB gold test and some MONTU test. This is coming from a perspective of a guy sitting in a tier 3 city of India and thinking from that angle, how would you rate TB gold, the test like TB gold or MONTU test, all those tests regarding a suspected spinal tuberculosis?
We all are harboring TB bacteria. These tests will be like at most non-specific. They will not have any value in terms of diagnosing this particular lesion. So to be true, I never do these tests. Even the Mantu test or the TB Gold, in my practice, I have never done these.
Superb. So that was the point which we want to make across, that don't depend a lot on the laboratory test, so-called laboratory test, to diagnose tuberculosis of the spine. And what you need to think on is along the lines of getting a microbiological diagnosis. Yes, Satin. Yeah.
Yeah. So for the biopsy, Dr. Dalvi, any thoughts in your mind about the biopsy? Would you like to send it to a radiologist or would you like to do it yourself?
Well, actually, a lot depends on the individual practice and on your comfort level. My individual practice is that I send all biopsies to the radiologists, because the interventional radiologists who I know are very good at getting results. They do it with a CT scan and they have the patience to do it. It requires extreme patience to do these biopsies. This would be probably one of the simplest ones because there's a huge abscess there, but there are some very difficult ones where you require to get a bone core, or there is a very little small lesion which is seen somewhere. So I think, let everybody do their job. You know, let everybody do their job. So let the interventional radiologists do their job. Having said that, if you're in a smaller city where the interventional radiologists are not clued in and, you are able to take responsibility, then you can go to the CT scan suite and do it yourself. A CT-guided biopsy would be far superior to a SIAM-guided biopsy. I'm not saying that a SIAM-guided biopsy is not possible. Yes, of course, it's possible. We put screws through SIAM, so why not biopsy? But a CT-guided biopsy gives you 100% confirmation of the tip of the needle. And, you are at least one error, because there are a lot of errors in getting a biopsy. At least one error is diminished as much as possible if you do it by a CT scan and if you do it by a wide bore. So that is one thing. I think the most important thing, unless that is next, I think the most important thing after doing the biopsy is to what you are sending it for. Because my biggest problem sometimes is that a biopsy done outside, they have not done what I want them to do. And just a histopath is not enough. And you need to really do a TB BACTEC culture, which now is known as MGIT. And you really need to do a gene expert. And you need to do an aerobic and anaerobic culture as well for other organisms, in addition to histology. So these are very, very important. The gene expert is worth its weight in gold, as would be the MGIT from a good laboratory.
Great. So you've jumped ahead and given us a very important point already.
Sorry.
But Manish was going to talk about that. So when we get a biopsy,
I want to jump back. I actually want to jump back. I also want to inform everyone that TB Gold or immunological testing has been banned by the government of India. So it is now almost illegal to do.
It's officially banned now.
Yes.
Yeah, they were of not no use anyways for us. So a very important point here is that. Getting these, when you send a biopsy, you need to get your histopathology sent. You need to get a gene expert. A gene expert is very important because it will tell you about if there is MTB present and whether there is any rifampicin resistance or not. Then your MGIT culture, your TB culture. In this case, particularly since we are not sure, there is a little bit of doubt whether it could be bacterial, so gram positive and gram negative cultures as well. Dr. Srivastav, sir, I wanted to ask you about the biopsy. You must have sent to various people for getting biopsies done in the past since a long time. What are the common mistakes which people make in getting in biopsy? Do you have any thoughts on which tissues that we should be taking and what mistakes people have made and what is the best way to get the biopsy?
I think he is not in the meeting right now.
Can I ask that question to Dr. Abhay Nene?
Yeah, very much. So number one is that poor sterilization, poor sterile precautions, and you carry in a staph epidermidis from the skin. The other is wrong size of needle. FNACs are preferred by a lot of radiologists or surgeons because much easier and they feel it's safer. The third is not targeting the lesion. There's some controversy here because in the past we would say that you got to get granulation tissue, but our very recent study, which is about to be published, suggests that there's enough data coming out of pus also. But I would rather that two or three biopsy specimens are taken per spine, per lesion, so that you're most likely to get the correct sample. The fourth is what Dr. Samir said, inadequate, sending this stuff for inadequate. I think he put the smear. A smear becomes a very important immediate test because it's positive, then you're all set. So I think these are the kind of, and then of course, sending it to the good labs compared to a Chalu lab next door, because some of the like things like MGIT has to be done in a well acquired lab. I think those are the key points.
Yeah, great. Those are very, very important points which you have mentioned. Uday, you want to summarize this?
So importantly, based on your clinical radiological parameters, with some help from the laboratory parameters, the crux of diagnosing the spinal tuberculosis is getting a microbiological diagnosis. There are no two ways about it. In today's Asian time, you should at least make an attempt to get a microbiological, get a biopsy of the spine, considering all the points which have been told by the experts. So make an effort to get a microbiological diagnosis and then only proceed from there, because that's very critical. Now, let me be devil's advocate and ask Dr. Dalvi that in situations you get a biopsy and the biopsy, when the gene expert says that there is no MTB, then even the histopathology shows you some sort of epithelioid granuloma and showing that tuberculosis, but the culture, you wait it out for longer and the culture just doesn't show anything. Then what would
your scenario actually is a simple answer, because you have said there are caseating epithelioid granuloma suggestive of TB. I would say, given that the spine has got a Posse bacillary disease, it is not easy to culture. It's Posse bacillary, and our biopsy is a needle biopsy. So any evidence that it is TB is good enough. So if you've got caseating granulomas, I think it's good enough to start AKT in the clinical setting. I mean, the only other thing which it can be is non-tuberculous mycobacteria, which happens in instrumented cases, operated cases. So what happens is that if you have any one evidence, I'm happy to start AKT for that patient. You get stuck if there is no evidence. I think that's the question you should be asking me, or maybe we're going to go down the line and answer that
question. The same question was the next one, that if you're stuck with no diagnosis in spite of a biopsy.
So now that's where your clinical judgment comes in, and each case is individual. So it would also depend on the type of case which it is. Now, if you're looking at a 35-year-old male with no other diseases and a chronic indolent infection, like he's been having back pain for 3 to 4 months, and to you, everything looks like TB, you can seriously sell the idea of so-called empirical AKT to that patient. But you need to explain the patient, you need to consent the patient that we're going to give you AKT, we're going to wait, we're going to repeat your investigations and repeat an X-ray and MRI. And if we are correct, if these things is getting resolved, then it is TB, and we'll continue to treat you for the full course. This is empirical AKT, it's not an AKT trial, it's an empirical AKT. It's a treatment modality. It's an investigator modality combined with the treatment modality. But if you look at another scenario where you've got like a 65-year-old patient with CRF and diabetes. Now here, because we're looking at probabilities, and the probabilities are as to how high is the probability of TB, or how high is the probability of it being something else. So like in our hospital, we have so many CRF patients, and all of them turn out to be non-tuberculous, and diabetics and elderly patients with UTI, women, elderly
compromised
women.
Your situation changes.
Yes, and elderly women, many of them with UTI. And the other is the clinical course. If there's an acute course of severe pain, again, it's more likely to go against TB. At that stage, you then have to decide whether you want to. I wouldn't give empirical AKT to such a patient. And what I would try and do is either get another biopsy, or alternatively, if there are other soft indications for surgery, I would add this as a soft indication for surgery, and altogether sell the patient the idea that, okay, why don't we do a surgery which will take care of your pain, blah, 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 diagnosis, debridement, etc., and we'll get your diagnosis as well, as opposed to doing another biopsy. Bottom line is, I will be very, very hesitant to give empirical AKT to any of these odd cases.
So supremely put.
I'll put this question to Dr. Nene as well. What would he do in a case like this? Immunocompromised patient with chronic renal failure, and you do a biopsy, you don't get any conclusive evidence. Also, even if you operate on these patients, sometimes you don't grow any bacteria. So how do you treat these patients?
So typically, the clinical profile of a non-TB is quite specific. They come in with a lot of pain, a lot of high inflammatory markers, sometimes fever. Basically, they're in significant pain, and the MRI normally does not look like this. So no one commented on the MRI. This MRI has multiple bony involvement. It's got a lot of osteitis, a lot of reactive bone. It's got an end plate involvement with a disc involvement, and fulminant abscess. That all is signs of tuberculous infection. When you look at MRI, TB versus pyogenic, these are all signs that go in favor of TB. So with an MRI like this, I may still harbor a notion of giving AKT without if the biopsy is negative. But in a renal failure with acute fulminant signs, you've got to think of pyogenic as the first diagnosis. Of course, getting cultures, etc. is worthwhile because you often get another source of the infection.
So we'll go ahead to the biopsy. I'll invite Dr. Manish Kothari to give his talk on the role of biopsy in TB spine. Manish, can you share your slide, please?
Hello, everyone.
Go ahead, Manish.
Am I audible?
Yes, Manish.
Yes,
okay.
Go ahead. Yes,
Manish. Sorry. Yeah, thank you, BSS and BOS, for this fantastic meeting. I'll be talking on biopsy in tuberculosis of the spine. Now, this is a recent newspaper article which is showing the BMC data of the tuberculosis and MDR and XDR, which is rising day by day, and which makes the case for biopsy even stronger. You don't want to miss these patients. We all know TB is a great masquerader. So TB looks like other lesions and other lesions look like TB. So the only way to know is biopsy. The unfortunate part is that the diagnostic yield of needle biopsy is highly variable or historically. So it has been discouraging, expensive. You end up spending around 30 to 40,000 average per biopsy, including the test. It many times is answerless because there is no result after a biopsy. And ultimately, it is disappointing. But that should not make the biopsy obsolete, and we should not resort to empirical treatment in cases where biopsy is possible. We just need to get better. So that is a message I want to give today. And so let's start with the principles of biopsy. The first is, if the patient is already on any antibiotics, you need to stop that beforehand. If it is a suspecting a bacterial, then probably two to three days is sufficient if no neurological deficit. If it is already on, a patient is on AKT, then waiting for about a week or two might give you better yield. Other is, look for other easily available sites like sputum or a superficial lymph node, which can be taken very easily. If you have to take it from the spine and there are multiple lesions, then the most accessible area is preferred over the least accessible. So sacrum is the most and easily accessible versus the cervical spine. And tissues are overall better than necrotic bone. So you always prefer to, if there is a paraspinal collection as shown in the previous case, then you'd like to take a paraspinal tissue rather than a bone tissue from a collapsed bone, which is frequently necrotic. And last but not the least is, the samples should reach the lab as soon as possible. You don't do a biopsy in the evening and send the samples tomorrow early in the morning. You should plan it during the working hours. Now, what tests to send? I think Dalvi sir has already listed them out. I'll just talk shortly on them. So Gene Expert is the first test I will always send. I will never miss on this test. It has been found that the pus samples are better with Gene Expert than with tissue. It detects both dead or alive M tuberculosis by PCR method. And it also detects the gene responsible for rifampicin resistance, which tells us this is MDR. Why MDR? Because it has been shown historically that when there is rifampicin resistance, there is invariably isoniazid resistance also. So this by definition goes into an MDR category. The next test is a Gram stain and an AFB smear. AFB smear also is important because if you want to do a line probe assay, then you need your patient, the smears should be positive. Also, patients in whom smears are positive, the likelihood of getting a culture positive or a Gene Expert positive is also very high. Next test is to send a TB culture and sensitivity by MGIT, the BACTEC 960 method. You will get reports on this at 3 weeks and 6 weeks. It is important to counsel the patients that you will get the reports at 3 weeks and again at 6 weeks. Invariably, so many times I have seen the patient forget to pick up the 6 weeks report and they think that nothing has been found and the report is actually lying in the lab. I always combine this with aerobic culture and sensitivity.
if the patient has been on antibiotics already, then I will ask for a long incubation of up to 3 weeks in the lab. Never to miss fungal smear and culture. I've seen 2 cases in CKD patients where it looked like Cox, 6 months history, looks typically like Cox on MRI. It turned out to be aspergillosis. And again, finally, is a histopath. It's a very classical saying, always culture what you send for histopath, and always send for histopath whatever you culture. It's the combined picture with all these tests that you'll be able to make a very accurate diagnosis. If you think it is TB on MRI and you just send TB, gene export and TB culture, that is not sufficient. You have to send all these tests to not to miss anything else. Now, a special comment on the gene export. The gene export machines have been upgraded. There's a new ultra machine that is coming, which has increased sensitivity and specificity. This is an overall of pulmonary and non-pulmonary values. So it is very high sensitivity in culture, culture positive, 99.5. And even in smear negative, it goes a little low, but still good enough. And specificity is around 95%. Now, looking at extrapulmonary tuberculosis, which are classically posibacillary tuberculosis, the sensitivity is still very high, up to 97%, provided your sample is good. That is an important point, provided your sample is good. And it has around 85% of specificity. It can still have 9% false positives and about 1% of false negatives. Another study with specifically regarding tuberculosis of the spine, it still says around 80 to 90% of specificity and much higher, almost 94% sensitivity. Now we are coming to an era of gene expert. Even the most RNTCP government and the BMC protocols now include gene expert in, and along with the smear. Smear alone is no more. Smear and culture is no more the only method used. Gene expert is very much a part of all our national programs. And when you combine MRI with gene expert, the rapidity of your results as well as the accuracy increases very, very high. So 97.9% sensitivity to detect M tuberculosis and almost 100% sensitivity to detect rifampicin resistance. Now, what does that mean? It reduces the time to detect an MDR-TB. Classically, it was almost 9 months average before gene expert was available. Many patient, MDR patients would get missed, but now we can get it done in 2 days, provided we do a good biopsy. Now, coming to the techniques of biopsy, FNAC, I'm just mentioning, it is not encouraged. I do not recommend FNAC unless it's from a lymph node in the neck or some other region. Next is a CT-guided biopsy. This is the workhorse of your all biopsies for tuberculosis where the patient does not have any indication for surgery. It is easy, it is safe, it causes almost no pain. OPD basis, it can be done and the patient can go back home within an hour or two. It can reach the most difficult areas and the yield is around 60 to 90% depending on who is doing it. Centers that do it regularly have much higher yield. Centers that have an untrained or a newer radiologist or staff, then the results are highly variable. So these are some of the examples. It can reach very difficult areas like C1, which you cannot go by fluoroscopy. It can target very small and specific lesions in the spine. It can go to the paraspinal areas where the vessels and the kidneys are so close. You cannot do it under fluoroscopy. The CT is the best way, the safest way to do it. And it can also go close to vessels, as I said. Now, there are various needles that are used. Most radiologists use the Waldman needle, which is this one. It's an 18-gauge semi-automatic needle. It's slightly expensive, but it gets reasonable tissue. Other are the core tissues. When you want a specific core of a bone or through the bone, then these help. There are some criticisms with these Cook needles is that it causes crushing of the tissues. As if it's a culture, it doesn't matter, but in histopath, it may cause some diagnostic errors. Next, we come to fluoroscopic guided biopsy. They are also relatively easy, but you need to be inside the bone, which means you have to enter the bone through the pedicle. It needs a longer admission, probably a daycare admission or so. And the yield is similar to a CT-guided biopsy, provided you take a large enough needle. If you take
13 gauge needle, then your results will be very poor. If you use 8 gauge needles, your needles will be much better. As long as you are inside the pedicle, you can reach whatever regions you want. Like you can go to the upper vertebra or in the disc space as well. I've tried to modify this a bit. I use a large working channel from a vertebroplasty cannula, and I use these 2 mm forceps, and I try to grab a good tissue to get a good sample. And this is the kind of samples we can get, and the results are very good. Now, in the fluoroscopic technique, I'll just go through how to do it. You go from the upper and outer part, and you enter the targeted lesion. And as you go inside, you should not breach the medial border of the pedicle before you cross the posterior cortex, or else you'll be in the canal. Or if you are too lateral, you may go outside. And to be perfectly inside the pedicle, you should have crossed the posterior border before you cross the medial border of the pedicle. Last, I'll complete with an open biopsy. So open biopsy still has a place. When CT biopsy has failed, or the patient has already has an indication for surgery, which is stabilization reconstruction, if the patient has deficit, deformity, or instability. When possible, always use minimally invasive techniques. If you are not stabilizing, you can use an endoscope or a tubular retractor if feasible. So take home messages. Always biopsy when you can. Send the entire battery of tests, as said earlier. Always send histopath also. Not everything is TB, and not TB. Other diagnoses can also be possible. If the biopsy fails, then you need to go in with a more invasive method. Whether it is an open biopsy or a surgery is indicated, you need to take that step. And if the as I said, if the patient needs surgery, the open biopsy will anyways be done. Thank you.
Thank you, Manish. Thank you for your presentation. So our take-home messages here have been very nicely said by Manish already. The biopsy is mandatory. We need to get this done always before we start our on treatment. MDR is much more common than we thought, and we need to rule it out for sure. Gene expert is very useful, a very useful investigation, and it's very helpful for us to detect MDR early. A core sample is useful, but we are using the abscess tissue as well. And we are getting good results from abscesses as well. As said earlier by our faculty, a good laboratory, you got to send it to a good laboratory where this kind of work is done routinely. And of course, you need to correlate with your radiology as we discussed earlier. So now taking this further ahead, we know this patient's biopsy has been performed, and the patient has got MTB on gene expert rifampicin. There is no resistance. Now, would you straight away like to start first line of treatment? Uday, you want to take this further?
Yes. Can we get Agnivesh here?
Yes, sir.
Yes, Agnivesh. What's your further line of management from here?
So the patient is having a MTB positive on gene expert, and there's no resistance to rifampicin, which means that he would be sensitive to the sensitive to the first line TB drugs. So I would think of starting on the first line TB drugs. In my practice, I usually refer them to a chest physician to start the medicine. But if you are sort of at a place where you do not have a facility for a TB specialist, then orthopedician can also take the onus of treating the TB medicines by himself.
Amit, do you also send these patients to a chest physician, or do you start the medication on your own?
No, actually, I agree with Agnivesh that I also preferably would like to send the patient to a chest physician, because it's not only about starting those four drugs, but at the same time, I need to know the right doses as per the patient's weight. And if patient develop any side effect of any of the medication, so which one to stop for how long, which investigations to be done, and how to titrate the doses, and when to start the medicine back, and which medicines to be given to kind of counteract the side effect of that particular medicine. So yes, I mean, almost always I refer my patient to a chest physician to start the AKT.
Dr. Nene, why is everybody, you know, we usually used to start this first line on our own, and you know, we start just give the treatment. Why are people now shifting towards involving the chest physicians or physicians who treat this regularly? Why are they involving them earlier now?
And just to add on to that, what's wrong with AKT4 for everybody?
Yeah.
Trap question. So AKT4, first the second question, because AKT4 is a very easy prescription. It's a very orthopedic friendly prescription. Whoever has made it has marketed it well. But actually, it is eligible for nobody in our group. It's eligible for only people who are 50 kilos or under. None of us in the group have that. So, you know, fixed drug combinations can be a real problem. And the reason to refer to chest physicians, you know, frankly, is that the commonest cause of MDR is faulty prescription by the prescribing doctor. And historically, it's been us. So historically, we've been the culprits for creating MDR, you know, much more than the bug itself. So no matter how much we pride ourselves at being able to, you know, actually know our AKT prescriptions, the fact is that the majority of us do not. Aside of that, the follow-up, quite rightly said by Amit, the side effects, the potential of this switching to a secondary MDR and, you know, getting a chest physician involved later. So in a tertiary care city like ours, I think it makes sense for us to let the right person do the right job. Having said that, I think in a, you know, less tertiary center, I think it's completely legitimate for the orthopedic surgeon to run his own AKT.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask Abhijit. Abhijit, are you here?
Yeah.
Have you also had problems with this medication? Or do you get any first of all, do you get any investigations done before you start this investigation for these patients, or you just have become completely like hands off and you just want to straight away send them to a physician for treatment?
Yeah, I usually send them to an infectious disease specialist, and because you know these medicines have side effects, and the dose has to be adjusted according to weight. And they would follow up the cultures, and so I would prefer to send them to infectious disease specialist, and they would do the lab tests like the LFTs, CRPs, and all those. I leave it to them.
Okay, this is the I guess this is a problem with having specialists in the tertiary centers that you know you get the specialist involved at every stage, and so this patient was also started on that, but for discussing further on the medical management, I would want to ask Dr. Abhijit Pawar to please share your talk on how you would send it to the physician, what he would do in medical management of pot spine.
Thank you, Satyan. Can you see my slide, Satyan?
Yes, yes, go ahead.
So I'm going to talk about medical management of TP spine. So we start with the first slide, which Manish had just finished the last slide. So before we start the medications, you need to have a definitive diagnosis, as we just pointed out in this whole discussion. And we have done a biopsy, we have sent the specimen for histopath, gene expert, and or the reef ultra, which gives us quick results in about 2 hours, even if the bacteria are about 16 per ml. And it gives us information about rifampicin resistance, which is very important information before you start the treatment. We also send the sample for TB culture, which is gold standard, and it comes positive even if the bacteria are about 10 bacteria per ml. We need to know that if the patient has already received AKT or drugs which have anti-TB activity, like linezolid, amikacin, quinolones, so this TB culture might come negative. If the TB culture is positive, then it is wise to do the INH susceptibility to begin with. In all these patients, the drug sensitivity testing is done using the BACTEC and MJ90 system as told by Manish. By the time we get the results of this drug sensitivity testing, it is necessary to start the first line chemotherapy while the results are pending. And there are other micrometallurgic methods like the line probe assay and line probe assay 2, which tells us about resistance to INH and rifampicin, as well as resistance to quinolones and aminoglycosides. So all these tests are necessary before we start the chemotherapy. But while the results are awaited, we start the first line therapy for tuberculosis. Now, the treatment for the first line treatment for tuberculosis for patients who are gene expert positive and rifampicin sensitive, as in the case which was shown by Satyan. So that is 2 months of INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol. That's the initial phase, and 10 months of continuation phase of INH, rifampicin, and ethambutol. If the first line therapy is, if the patient is microbiologic negative and you are suspicious of tuberculosis, still you start the first line therapy and it's the same. 2 months of INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol, and 10 months of INH, rifampicin, and ethambutol. So INH, the dose is 300 milligram per day. Rifampicin is 450 milligram per day for patients who are less than 50 kgs, and patients who are more than 50 kgs, it's 600 milligram per day. Pyrazinamide is 1000 to 1500 milligram per day. Ethambutol 800 to 1200 milligram per day. And we need to give pyridoxin 20 milligram per day for the side effects because of INH and rifampicin. Now, the duration of treatment, there is a lot of dilemma regarding duration of treatment for AKT. The WHO has different recommendations. Dr. Nene has recently published this paper in Spine Journal, where they had 6 versus 12 months of antituberculosis treatment in patients with biopsy-proven tuberculosis. And they had a conclusion that these patients who had 6 months versus 12 months of therapy had similar results at the end of 24 months. So I think he will throw some light on this study and give us some recommendations. But as of now, according to the revised National Tuberculosis Control Program in India, the first line therapy is 2 months of INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol for 2 months, and in the initial phase, and 10 months of INH, rifampicin, and ethambutol in the continuation phase. These medications have side effects, so you need to have a baseline test like the LFTs, uric acid, and to monitor the side effects, SGOT, SGPT. INH can cause hepatitis, peripheral neuropathy, cutaneous reactions, hypersensitivity. Rifampicin can also lead to hepatitis, thrombocytopenia, skin reactions, flu-like syndrome. Pyrazinamide can lead to anorexia, nausea, flushing, hepatitis, arthritis, skin hypersensitivity. Ethambutol can lead to retrobulbar neuritis, arthralgia. Streptomycin, as we all know, can lead to ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, giddiness, tinnitus, skin reaction, ataxia, vertigo. So all these medicines have significant side effects. Now, patients who have INH resistance, you do a drug sensitivity testing and it shows INH resistance. In those patients, you need to start rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol along with levofloxacin for 12 months. The levofloxacin, the dose is 750 milligram daily in patients who are less than 75 kgs in weight, and 1 gram daily in patients who are 75 kgs in weight. Suppose the drug sensitivity says DST shows the rifampicin resistance. There is always after microbiologic diagnosis and after DST. So this is done in consultation with an infectious disease or a chest physician, as discussed previously. The drugs for rifampicin resistance are these: moxifloxacin 400 to 600 milligram per day, linezolid 600 milligram per day, clofazimine 100 to 200 milligram per day, cyclosarin 500 to 750 milligram per day, injection amikacin 750 milligram per day, and others are ethionamide pass, the newer drugs like bidaquiline and delaminide. Now you need to start at least 4 drugs. In my institute, I prefer to involve infectious disease team, and they take care of these issues. And the duration of this therapy is about 12 to 18 months. So that's for rifampicin resistance. And so the message here is anti-COX treatment is a chemotherapy. So please do not take it lightly. These medicines have side effects. The AKT is weight adjusted and time bound. You need to give proper dose according to the weight, and you need to avoid drug interactions. You need to monitor the side effects, ensure compliance. The side effects are plenty. So you need to counsel the patient before you start the same. you need to counsel about rashes, red urine, redness in the sweat, fever, increase in pain, joint pain. You need to have an alarming, you need to raise an alarm if there is vision loss, which can occur because of ethambutol, jaundice because of rifampicin or INH, and neuropathy because of INH. So as soon as you identify these problems, you need to stop that respective medicine and start new drugs, which is usually two drugs at same time, not just one. So you need to monitor healing with serial follow-up. The healing markers of healing are three-dimensional. The first is clinical monitoring. You need to monitor the feeling of wellness and increase in appetite. That's a clinical monitoring of the patient. There is a laboratory test you need to follow up with in this patient. There is ESR, CRP, uric acid. The LFT is, as we told, as SGOT, SGPT, and serum creatinine. There is radiological monitoring of this patient with X-rays and MRIs. MRIs about every 4 months, 4 to 5 months, and X-rays about every second month. So the carry-home message for anti-cox treatment is anti-tuberculosis treatment is a serious therapy. Please do not take it casually. It is not just start AKT therapy, start AKT4 and it's done. It's not like that. You need to have empirical anti-cox treatment has a limited role in the era of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, as Dr. Nene rightly told right now. Anti-cox treatment has promising results. You need to diagnose early and convincingly with a good biopsy and some blood test and histopath examination. Optimum drugs in an optimum manner, and they have to be given for optimum duration as well. You have to monitor the healing three-dimensionally with a serial follow-up, and it is the responsibility of the clinician to not to create an MDR tuberculosis, as Dr. Avinayana told us right now. So the main reason for MDR is us, the clinicians, for giving the inappropriate dose and not doing a proper biopsy or not having a proper diagnosis to begin with.
Great. Thank you, Abhijit.
So Abhijit has actually opened not literally a can of worms, but sort of a controversial area again. And before we give it to Dr. Nene to finalize the, give the sort of final verdict on this thing regarding the duration of AKT.
I wanted to ask, Dr. Dalvi
and Dr. Mihir as well.
And Dr. Mihir. So Dr. Mihir, are you here? I wanted to ask you about this patient. Now this, as Abhijit said, mentioned, you know, MDR, when you start anti-tubular therapy for these patients, you can't just leave them and you need to monitor them properly. You need to monitor them clinically through laboratory and through radiology. So in your practice, how often do you call these patients? Would you ask them to come over and every month? Or how do you monitor them?
The red flags has to be counseled to the patient in case they feel that there is loss of sensations or a feeling of buckling when they stand up. They have to report SOS. Otherwise, like everybody just agreed upon that most of my medical treatment is managed by physicians, and that is not difficult to get even in day-to-day practice. You can have a physician recruited. For regular follow-ups, it is 6 weeks, 3 months, 6 months, 9 months. With serial ESRs, the blood parameters, X-rays, and no MRI before minimum 4 months of starting of AKT.
Dr. Dalvi, what would you expect? Do you also get the MRI done at 4 months or do you wait longer? And what do you expect at that stage?
I think 4 months is a very good time to do it. There are times when you would do it earlier. Like for instance, if the patient is not doing clinically, it's a call, you know, it's a call which you take. I usually call the patient after 2 months, the first time. And if the patient is not doing well, going downhill, you have a doubt of the diagnosis or you think that the drugs are not working. If there is any negative or unhappy situation occurring, you may do the MRI earlier. But otherwise, 4 months is a good enough time. And that has been the protocol. Of course, one of the warnings which should be given maybe at this point is that the MRI has its own errors. And the earlier you do the MRI, you're going to land up with more errors. If you do an MRI at 1 month, the disease is going to look incredibly worse. And at 2 months also, it may look worse. So if you are doing an early MRI, you should be able to balance the clinical picture with the MRI picture. Don't get just carried away only by the MRI picture. That's very, very important. So in the original protocol, we were doing the MRIs at 4 months. Nowadays, I feel that if patient is doing well and clinically he's okay, then, you know, I sometimes feel that patient economically challenged, we don't really force him to do it. I would just probably do an MRI at completion. It's a good protocol to do it at 4 months, but you can do it at completion if clinically everything is going well. Patient is gaining weight, ESR is coming down, pain is getting better, x-rays are looking good. You can, you don't have to do an MRI at 4 months, but you can.
And great, a quick word, about the, word about the duration of AKT from both of you, Meer sir and Sameer sir.
For me, I haven't got down to reading Abhay's paper yet. So for me, it's 9 months.
Yeah. I totally agree with Sameer. I have still kept it at 9 months. What we need to understand is that the MRI runs ahead of the clinical diagnosis. When it comes to diagnosis, MRI picks up the disease earlier, but when it comes to recovery, MRI lags behind the clinical recovery. So MRI should be later.
Abhay sir, can you throw a light on your paper regarding 6 months to 12 months?
Just for the duration of AKT, I think the paper is a pilot study and it definitely says that you don't need to give AKT for longer than 12 months. And on a case-to-case basis, I think you can go anywhere between 6 and 12 months. But it, I think, clearly tells us that it can go as less as 6 months and as high as 12 months. I'm just going to take 3 minutes to quickly run this paper down your throat,
sure,
because
sure.
It was a prospective randomized study. It was it was blinded to the primary reviewer, a primary researcher, and 50 patients with all sorts of tuberculosis consecutive were, alternately or randomly put into the surgical and, I mean, the 12 month and 6 month group. They were surgical patients, non-surgical patients, cervical TB, lumbar TB. So it was a very genuine effort. And it turned out, the healing, because there are no healing criteria, right? There's no way to say that this is healed. We waited for 2 years after stopping AKT to look to call this person a healed status. So if there was no recurrence of disease for 2 years after stopping AKT, it was considered. So that also seems like a rock solid criteria. And we found the same amount of recurrence, which is very low in the 6 month category as well as the 12 month category. So it's compelling evidence, though the numbers were clearly short to call this a path breaking evidence. It's definitely a pilot study enough to at least tell those neurosurgeons who give AKT for 20 and 30 months for spinal tuberculosis that they don't need to do that.
Fantastic, sir. Thank you so much.
Dr. Nene, taking this further, have you had patients where you've stopped AKT thinking that, okay, now my 9 months or whatever are complete and the patient looks like it is healing? It's not fully healed on the MRI and X-ray, which we don't expect as early. But the patient comes back after maybe a year or so with the abscess increased and with symptoms again. Have you had this ever?
Literally none, because nowadays the homework on day zero is a lot. So in the past, when the homework was not done adequately, a lot of wish-wash would happen. But I think today I have not had such a situation. I don't know about Dr. Dalvi or Dr. Bapat, if what their experience says.
No, I think I have had one or two cases who have presented maybe 6 months down the line with a recurrence. But really, the adequacy of AKT on the basis of our criteria, when we stopped it, all the criteria were fulfilled. That means that we even got an MRI showing that there have been a significant reconstitution. So it was probably a genuine recurrence of sorts. So if you have evidence, you can still stop the AKT.
Just to have sort of a show of hands or not, or just an appreciation, are we yet there considering mentally that we are okay to stop, apart from Dr. Nene, I guess, to stop AKT at 6 months, or we are probably still a little bit longer than that? And we are most of us are comfortable of AKT for 9 months to a year duration.
Would we be so comfortable as to preach this in our webinar, okay, now you can stop at this stage, or... I think, or should we still say, okay, no, 9 to 12 months?
I can speak on behalf of our president, Dr. Rajshekaran, who stops at 6 months routinely for primary AKT, for primary TB.
No, I think Abhay gave a very important message, is that the healing of the disease, there is solid evidence that the healing is adequate at 6 months. But if you want to give a continuation therapy from 6 to 12 months should be the farthest you should go. You should not go beyond that. So this is what Abhay was trying to mean. So you can stop it at 7 months, 8 months, 9 months. So on the basis of our clinical experience, me and Sameer have chosen 9 months. But we certainly don't want to carry it to 12 months. So probably we can stop it even at 8 months.
I think one thing is clear that at the end of 12 months, even if there is some small residual abscess, we should just not bother about it and continue AKT. That's message number one. Is that what you all mean?
I think that's a very important message for the northern hemisphere of our country and for the neurosurgeons.
Right. And second particular point is that if a patient is not doing clinically well at 12 months of AKT, that means AKT is not working. Is that the second point to be taken forward?
I think absolutely right. And these situations should be preempted. You should not land in this situation at all. That's a very strong message, prior to these two messages.
Exactly. No, I think most of the MRI reports say there is significant regression. There is still residual abscess. And there is still some amount of osteomyelitis left. Now, these are MRI reports. You really have to take the holistic picture and stop the AKT.
I'd like to say something about this duration of AKT and the studies. See, honestly, TB is too heterogeneous a disease. Like, if you treat, you cannot get this answer unless you have 10,000 patients. It is based on the individual bacilli factor. It is based on the host factor, how the patient has an immunological response. It is also based on drugs. You know, what company drug you have, whether drug, how they are taking, their absorption factors. To really get this study, you have to study 10,000 patients. And plus, you there are no endpoints for healing or cure. And we cannot culture the bacteria well. Now, what we want AKT to do is not heal the TB. The TB is healed by immunology, by the body. What the AKT does is kill the bacilli. What the MRI shows you and the X-ray shows you is healing. The bacilli may be dead at 2 months also for all you know in some patients. So we don't know, but there is no way of finding out. Unless you have a precise way of 100% sampling a bacilli on day one and then keeping on sampling to see which of these bacilli are dead and doing this study in 10,000 patients, you can never know this answer. And therefore, it is, as is pointed out, safe. We don't need to go beyond 12 months. It's a very, very good thing. We can go 6 months is good, but if you're safe, 9 to 12 months is safe. Because I don't think we can ever get this answer properly.
I guess it's a perfect summarization.
Final verdict.
And I'll tell you, for instance, I'll tell you, like if you know, a swing does not a swallow make. I have a patient who was seen in March and sent for a biopsy for TB. That patient, because of lockdown, came to me in the last OPD. We are now in October, right? This patient, I got another MRI done. This patient is completely healed. It is TB grown, X-rays, histopath, everything positive. Not taken one drop of AKT, not taken any medication. And on the MRI is completely healed. Now, please explain this. This means that 0 days of AKT also cures TB. Now, when you are dealing with such a heterogeneous disease, you know, I have other patients who have 2 years of AKT and still nothing is growing, no culture, not this thing, but still not healed. So it's very difficult. You have to take it on a case-to-case basis. And as a general rule, 9 months to 12 months seems to be a good picture based on the huge evidence. And you have to respect the new evidence which is being created by Abhay and have an open mind to 6 months as well.
Yeah, I think it's nicely summarized. What we're saying is that we need to do it according to the patient, how the patient is responding. Exactly. And it's not has to be a general thing for all. Now, coming back to this patient, this lady who's a 29-year-old fit female who got a biopsy done where it was found that it was rifampicin sensitive, no resistance, started on AKT. And again, she has been following up because of the lockdown. She has not come over. She's been calling me and telling me that, yeah, she's fine. She now has come recently and got her MRI done at 1 year follow-up. And this is what it shows now. Clinically, she is doing quite well. She doesn't have much pain. She has got a little bit of back stiffness. She is doing her exercises. And, she's eating better. There are no other symptoms. But this is what it shows. This is at 1 year. Now, what do you do? Would you want to get another biopsy done?
Showing a healing pattern. It's healing with collapse. If you see the osteitis is significantly cleared, the disease element is significantly cleared, she's getting more into an instability related problem. And that's where the confusion of healing comes. You rate healing as healing of the spine, but you got to dissociate healing of the spine from healing of the disease. And this is a perfect case in point.
No, yeah. I think this case is an overwhelming evidence that there's a rumbling disease. That means that the MRI at 1 year, if there is a residual abscess, I can understand. But if the abscess size has doubled, even if the bone has reconstituted, an abscess doubling surely means that there is something rumbling inside and you need a repeat biopsy. Because an MDR TB does not have to be MDR right at the beginning. It can become MDR during the course of your treatment. So this patient could have developed resistance during the course or could have been resistant right from the beginning. We don't know.
Amit, I'd like to get you in here. Now, this patient, we have done a biopsy at the beginning. She was sensitive. There's no signs of resistance. Clinically also, she is doing well. In fact, all her symptoms have come down. So would you still say that this is maybe now she's developed resistance? Or do you think that this is just a sterile the abscess which is coming down slowly? The osteitis has improved. Even on the MRI, it is better. However, you still see a huge, you know, this granulation tissue or whatever abscess, which is still slightly less than what it was earlier. But at 1 year, it is still present.
So basically, there are two, three things. Even if you go back to the patient's previous MRI, there was at one level, there was significant destruction of the bone. I don't know how much of the bed rest or the brace support the patient had taken, but that much destruction, even with the healing TB, probably can lead to further like mechanical damage to the vertebral bodies and can come with this kind of kyphotic picture. Now, so that's about the bone part of it. Now, coming back to the abscess part of it. So abscess, you know, like sometimes the abscess don't resolve for a very, very long time. I have had patients who were responding very well to the AKT, but on repeated MRI, they were showing like huge amount of abscess. So the chest physician told me that there is an entity called paradoxical reaction. So even in the late phase, when the patient is responding well, sometimes the abscess can actually go up. And the third thing is that he told me like that there could be inadequate dose of isoniazid. So isoniazid is not only the, like you can give it as per the body's weight. Sometimes you have to check the blood level also. So we checked the blood level of the patient and the isoniazid level in the blood were very, very low. So he kind of recalibrated entire thing and then gradually the patient's abscess resolved. So it could be one of these three possibilities.
Thank you. Abhijit, do you want to say something about this? Yeah, Abhijit. Yeah, yeah. So you think this is MDR?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it looks like an MDR because the abscess has significantly increased in size in spite of taking adequate treatment.
If the abscess is not increased, it has remained similar or slightly reduced based on the previous.
If you look at this previous MRI pictures, I think it has increased in size. So I would... The patient is likely to have severe back pain and
Patient is clinically fine. So I think what you're suggesting is that you would want another biopsy here.
Yeah, I would like to know whether this is MDR. Yeah.
Dr. Dalvi?
I think a lot would depend on the patient's clinical features. And if the patient is completely clinically silent, you are in a bit of a soup. You may then just do a needle biopsy just to make sure that you're not dealing with an MDR because we appreciate you got cultures on day one, but there are some which, you know, there are those which are de novo MDRs and those which then later on become resistant. So, you know, we need to really rule out whether it's MDR on because this is not the usual finding. It is okay, but it is not the usual finding. Having done that, you know, if she has no pain, there's a problem. If she had pain, then we would have to see whether she has destruction, instability, all of those. And I think an X-ray also gives you a very, very good idea as it's healing or not, an X-ray or a CT. Because if there's bony reconstitution, etc., then we know that it's healing and, you know, this is just an abscess. The question then remains with a sterile abscess like this, I'm always in two minds. I mean, one is you just leave it like that and eventually it either stays or goes away. And that is a very, very valid thing. The other thing is that if you're really aggressive about it, you can just do a very tiny operation and just drain the abscess. Dr. Larry used to always feel the abscess there erodes the bone. But I think a lot of literature says that these abscesses, sterile abscesses can stay for a long time and they don't cause any harm. So I would be slightly divided and I would sort of throw it to the patient. And if the patient doesn't want it, then I won't do it. And if the patient says that they want it, then I would do it. Because a very small costotransfersectomy will drain out this entire abscess. You know, it's not a big operation. It's a very tiny operation.
Would you want to get another Would you think another biopsy or draining that would help in getting
at the very least another biopsy, that's for sure, because this is not a difficult biopsy also. See, this is not, there's a little tiny thing, there's a huge abscess, anyone can stick in a needle and take out the pus. I think at the least which is incumbent on us is to do a biopsy. If at 1 year it is showing like this, irrespective of the symptoms, it's the least we can do is have a biopsy. If it is sterile, then we are at a soup. Then we can just wait. I mean, then we are justified in waiting and doing nothing.
So we'll take this further ahead. You know, we'll discuss about evaluation of healing in pod spine. I'd like to invite Dr. Nene. How do you evaluate? What do you see on radiological healing?
So, you know, on this point, I think the final verdict, though personally, I would leave this patient totally alone, because I think you're showing some parasagittal images, and I'm sure this abscess has reduced, and in my practice, I would leave him alone. I think the verdict from the faculty, which we need to give to the audience, is that if there is a residual abscess so late in the day, that's 12 months, you should get at least a biopsy, and you should increase the, you know, the threshold of suspicion. I think that's the verdict, isn't it?
Yes.
So we are led by this star-studded faculty who treats spinal TB, and everyone knows everything. But however, there are a couple of places where we don't know what we don't know, and we just very confidently, like they say, orthopedic surgeons often wrong but never in doubt. We just say that this is recovering, or we say this is not recovering. We say this is going to end up with kyphosis. This is not going to end up with kyphosis. Now, so how do you monitor recovery? Really, there's no good answer, and we are just going to clutch on to what we have. And there are three criteria to monitor recovery. As orthopedic surgeons, we like to see numbers, but unfortunately, numbers don't work here. The ESR and CRP, which are non-specific inflammatory markers, can go high or can go low. Having said that, you still need to do them, because your index markers can give you a general sense of which way you're going. And more importantly, since there's no absolute criteria, you got to clutch on all the strings you have. So I think there's no there's no reason not to do this on a regular basis, ESR and CRP. MRI remains a gold standard, and there was a time when we would consider healing on the basis of MRI scan. However, there's a controversy, and we just touched upon that some time ago. How often would you do MRI? And in our publication so far on conservative treatment of spinal TB, we've always been doing MRI at 3-monthly basis, for which we have been criticized. And there are people who like to say that MRI should never be done after your primary diagnosis. There's some people who say at the start of treatment and at the end of treatment, and some people who are effervescent like us who like to do it far more regularly. I'm just going to throw a few cases in point. This is a young radiologist who had a lesion and did not want to biopsy, and started on empirical AKT. And at the end of 3 months, she said she's mildly better. And we sent her back, and she came back in a week with a deficit. And the MRI showed a significant increase in the size of the abscess, and a fairly sudden onset deficit, of course, later turned out to be an MDR after surgery. So here, an MRI at 3 months would have bailed us out. Here's another case which was actually operated because there was a large anterior defect. And this was way back in time. We really didn't follow up the reports like Mihir mentioned. Manish mentioned. We forgot to collect reports. We sometimes forget to collect reports because the patient has done well. But she comes back at 2 months with recurring symptoms and a deficit again. And again, an MRI early in the day, showed that the abscess had grown. And this again turned out to be eventually MDR-TB. So in some select cases, there is a need to do an MRI more regularly. So my verdict, at least for this, would be that when you're on unsure grounds, when you're not sure about the diagnosis, not sure of the drug sensitivity, you got to use all the tools that you have in hand. When you're walking on a thin ice, you got to, try and utilize everything that's available in hand. When all the data points, all the boxes have been checked at the start of treatment, you can be very sure, sit back and watch. And including the case in point which Dr. Satyen is presenting, I would sit back and let this go, because I would not worry much. Because you see, when you look at the MRI, sometimes there's an initial worsening. Like in this case, the patient was significantly fine at 3 months, but the MRI showed worsening. And the two known reasons for this is, one is a reaction that, the early paradoxical reaction, where because of the, the immunity fighting the disease, there's a lot of inflammatory tissue which gets misinterpreted as the bug. It's not the bug, it's just inflammation on the MRI. The other is that nowadays, with the MRI being done so rampantly, you diagnose a disease way too early, and a disease's timeline to progress to a stage before the drugs can actually overwhelm it. So you would not worry if there's an initial worsening in the light of all boxes have been checked on day one and the patient is clinically doing well. On the other hand, the Chinese, this is of course an Indian, our patient, but the Chinese actually presented a series of stopping AKT at 3 months. And they've actually, or 8 weeks, I'm sorry, ultra short course regimen. It's the papers out there on PubMed. Of course, that alludes to this and what Dr. Sameer and Dr. Mihir said, that the disease can die early, but we're giving medicines to smother the bug so that there's no recurrence of the symptoms. And here is a case in point. So the wise orthopod would say that no modern investigation can substitute clinical acumen. And you got to go by these 4 points in red: improvement in symptoms, improvement in function, no brainer from an orthopedic standpoint. But a feeling of well-being and weight gain and increased appetite, we tend not to ask this. Remember, even spinal TB is a systemic disease, which is why your ESR is often raised. And this systemic wellness is also a part of healing. And here's a case that pretty much reflects the discussion we had some time back. This gentleman had this MRI at 6 months. At the end of 12 months, he was completely fine. At 6 months, he was fine. But those days, we would continue for 12 months. So this is early 2000s. And his MRI at 12 months still showed significant residual abscess. And, you know, we decided that we are not going to give more than 12 months because we are convinced that no one needs, the bug does not need more than 12 months of treatment. The spine may take longer to heal. And academically, we called this guy back because by then he was traveling by the local trains in Bombay. And at the end of 6 months of stopping AKT, which means you stop AKT and you see how the abscess has totally shrunk. And that's what I predict is going to happen in Dr. Satyen's case. Because it's just a serile residual tissue. It can take as long as it wishes to, you know, to actually take care of itself. And we alluded to this paper, and I don't want to go further into it, but all that I can say is that today there is no evidence to support 18 and 24 months of AKT. You can choose between 6, 9 and 12. It's your call. But I would say that go by a case-to-case basis. So in my practice today, at the end of 6 months, if all the criteria are satisfied, I'm happy to stop AKT. But I don't do that universally for all patients because the trial is over and I don't put everyone in that trial. So, you know, to conclude on this point, I would say that when you monitor recovery, your priority has to be clinical improvement, weight gain, improvement in appetite, reduction in pain, improved mobility, reduction in spinal signs. MRI should be a close second. I would recommend to do MRI more often because you're not going to just interpret the result that comes out in type. But you're going to process it through your head, look at the patient's clinical condition. You're the doctor, you're not a radiologist. So you're going to actually finally give the verdict based on all these. So an MRI just becomes an added tool. You don't have to look at it and, you know, fall prey to it. But it becomes an added tool, especially when there's no single criteria. I did not mention two things here. One is X-ray, because it takes a long time to show a change. But in some cases, sclerosis on X-ray can be a very good sign, suggesting it's that the bone is actually healing. The other is a PET scan, and I'm very skeptical. There's a lot of work being done by Dr. Jain and Dr. Shankaracharya, but I'm still very, very skeptical because the PET has no control. There's no control to all the studies that have been thrown at us. So to say that PET being negative means a sign of recovery, or conversely, PET being positive means presence of active disease, you prove that first to me before you can say that, because PET is a metabolic test. It's not a test for infection. And there are n number of occasions here in Bombay where we've misinterpreted TB as cancer. So I really don't think, at least from my end, I'm not going to give that as the final verdict. I think there's a long time before the PET can be used as one of the tools for monitoring. And I'm very skeptical about the studies that are coming based on a PET scan as a tool for healing. Lab markers should be, you know, used with discretion, but you don't want to miss on any of these because your resources are limited. I think I'll stop here rather than getting into the surgical aspect as we discuss, moderators, if that's okay.
Yes, that's fine. So about this PET scan, so, you know, we are able to understand MRIs much more now. But about our PET scan now, I mean, how wouldn't it be different to evaluate a TB spine on a PET scan as compared to like another infection, a pyogenic infection? Because these TB sometimes have got persisters and they become metabolically active later on. So
The first handicap of a PET is it can't identify the bug. It can say, you know, that there's a lesion here. The second one, which is very understated, people don't talk about it, but I'm going to ask all the faculty to comment. The differentiation between malignancy and infection is very, very poor on PET. And we've had at least two cases recently where a malignancy was touted and the patient was, you know, put in for a major surgery right here at Breach Candy, our patient. and it turned out to be pus and tuberculosis. And this was PET reported by the best guys in Bombay. And there was another case similar to this where then we fell for a biopsy. And I mean, we went in for a biopsy and we proved that this was infection. So I feel it can't even differentiate infection from malignancy just yet. I don't think we've reached that yet. And most importantly, I don't see how people can say that an active PET means active disease, because active PET means active metabolism. Even when the body is fighting the disease, there's inflammation there and the PET is likely to be active. It's okay to say that negative PET means negative disease, but that comes at 24 months. So are you going to say that the disease took 24 months to heal? I mean, I'd invite Manish, Agnivesh, Samir, Mihir, everyone to comment. Abhijit, Uday.
So my two cents on this will be like, you have to do PET prior to starting your you need to have a PET prior to your AKT as well. And similarly, as we do the MRIs, then we'll have to have a follow-up PET scan as well, which will then tell you the disease activity, whether it's gone down or not. You still can't depend only on PET to tell you whether the disease is active or not. You still have to depend on all the parameters. But where it can help is if you have it prior to your start of AKT as well. And then at follow-up, it'll tell you whether the disease activity has gone down or not.
I agree with you, sir. The PET is unreliable because it will pick up osteoblasts which are forming new bone and healing the gap as well. So it is very difficult to say what is metabolically active is infection or osteoblast, and whether, again, the diagnosis part, is it infection or malignancy. So it is just something is there, that's all. But what it is, it doesn't make any sense.
Can I say something regarding the PET?
Yes, certainly.
So I agree with absolutely the points that the PET, you can't predict healing and all, but we have been able to use PET to our advantages in 2-3 situations. One is that when you get a vertebral lesion without any abscess or anything, and you are wondering whether it's a malignancy or anything, PET has been able to give us an easier, like in 2 cases, we got nodes, one in the neck and one in the inguinal area. So we could biopsy them under ultrasound and we got it was TB. So we were thinking of malignancy and all. So PET helped us to get over.
In
that.
A multifocal lesion, yes, Agnivesh, what you're saying? You get the.
I'm talking a single lesion on an MRI with other ultrasound chest X-ray being negative, and that area is difficult to assess. So it can give you sometimes an easier biopsy site, which is more sort of lighting up. Correct. Second is that PET is again a very high radiation investigation. So you need to be justified to sort of prescribe it before you go ahead. And the last point is that PET and EMG NCV are 2 reports. I believe they are very, very much dependent on the person who is sort of doing it. So if the person is good, he will be able to differentiate between various sort of modalities. We have a very excellent person at our center who has helped us to differentiate even between a simple trauma and infection. And he has proved right. Means we have done the biopsy, done the cultures and all, and whatever he said preoperatively has turned out to be correct. So it's very, very much dependent on the person who is doing the PET CT reporting.
Okay.
Okay, great. So we'll take this ahead I'll conclude this case here. And our take home message is, you know, the final verdict here is that first of all, we need a biopsy, number one. It is a must. You need to confirm your diagnosis. You need to rule out your MDR right from the beginning. Repeat biopsies are also indicated if you don't feel that the patient is, doing as well clinically and radiologically as it should have been. MRI at the beginning, you know, in the first few months is greatly exaggerates the disease, and it should not be your indication that you just jump in for surgery if it shows. You don't even get an MRI done early. Resolution on MRI may take time. Usually you take 4 to 6 months for good resolution to be seen. And if you have any clinico-radiological correlation is not matching, you need to have a high index of suspicion on MDR, and you need to go ahead and reinvestigate and think about something else. So I'll go on to the next case for this patient. Dr. Uday, I'll want you to take over. I'll just explain. This patient was a 40-year-old female who had come with a lot of back pain. Neurologically, she was normal. And this is where she presented to another doctor, another surgeon, who started this patient on first-line ATT initially, and no biopsy or nothing was performed. And this patient then, after a month, came back with severe back pain, and she got weakness in her lower limbs, both her lower limbs had grade 2/5 power on catheter, and this is what she has. She came with later on.
So, Abhijit, what's your take on the case? Thoracolumbar query tuberculosis, empirical AKT worsening on treatment.
So, I think the biopsy was necessary. Just a minute. So, she has not responded to the medications. I would go and do a biopsy in this patient to find out what is the bacteria.
Grade 2 power she has come down to, Abhijit. Grade 2/5 power.
Okay.
Right now.
So this is 1 month later.
Yeah.
I would go do an open biopsy. I would do a decompress because now there is significant neurological involvement. There was a trial of AKT given to her, which has not worked properly. So I would like to do an open biopsy, decompress, stabilize, and give her a full chance for neurological recovery because now the spinal nerves and spinal cord is getting involved in this case. And it is at the level of conus. If we conserve this patient further, she might end up in severe neurodeficit and would not walk again.
So it's already grade 2/5. So probably will not occur at 2/5. Mir sir, any your 2 cents on this thing? You need to unmute yourself, sir.
In this case, of course, biopsy is always mandatory, but if you gauge the medical response, surprisingly, in 1 month, it has been very, very good. The lower lesion in L4 has almost reconstituted. The abscesses around the index lesion have reduced in size. There is a collapse. So that collapse could be just because the osteoporotic bone has collapsed and compressed the conus. But I wouldn't say that the lesion is not healing. The lesion has healed surprisingly very well, but the patient presented with a neurology and now you need to address the neurology as a surgeon. So during the surgery, you will still get a biopsy and you will study the response to his AKT.
Samir sir, any instances whenever you do a CT scan, because this looks like sort of healing, you don't know what's happening to the posterior vertebral wall of the L2. Do you get a CT scan or how do you go about this?
No, I mean, but I don't know about CT scan, but I will definitely at least get an X-ray. I love X-rays and I find that X-rays gives a lot of information. And we'll get some X-rays. If she's able to stand, then we'll get a standing X-ray and a supine X-ray to see what the instability is. And all investigations, everything apart, this case is a case for surgery. I think there is no beating around the bush over here. And this patient is for completely curative surgery for whatever it is. It is decompression. It is reconstruction, it is deformity correction. All whatever tools are armamentarium is with us, we have to use for this patient at this point. And then biopsy, of course, is done. And of course, the AKT or whatever, if it's an alternative diagnosis, then alternative therapy, or if it is AKT, if it's whatever it is, we do that. But this patient needs surgery. Finished. End of the story. That's it.
So the take home is like, if the patient is worsening right in front of your eyes, or if it's a so acute worsening, even if you have not seen the patient first, this case warrants a surgical intervention, especially if it's 2/5 power worsening. You need to go in, do a surgery, get the neurological tissue out of compression, stabilize it, get your biopsy and move ahead from there.
Yeah.
Satyen?
Yeah. So I'll just go ahead. In this case, we are talking about now posterior decompression and stabilization. So I'd like to invite Amit to come over and give his talk on posterior surgery in pot spine. Amit, are you around?
Yes, Satyen. Just opening my presentation.
Hello.
Is it seen?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Yeah. So, fondly, this procedure, what we are going to discuss, is called transpedicular decompression, though it's more like a transfacetal approach to the affected area, but many times we remove the pedicle part of the affected lower vertebral body also. So we use this term transpedicular decompression and reconstruction. So the principles of these procedures are no brainer. We have to target the anterior column through the posterior approach, and what we would like to achieve is the decompression of the spinal cord. especially anteriorly, because disease is mostly anterior, and then we have to kind of remove that epidural abscess anteriorly, the retropulse disc fragments and the bony fragments from the anterior part of the spinal canal. We have to debride the adjacent parts of the bone for the fusion, and we have to reconstruct and do our osteosynthesis and do our instrumentation. For the soft lesion, like in cases of TB, we have a different approach. And for a when the lesion is hard, like in late onset kyphosis or healed TB with kyphosis, the approach is slightly different. So I have this schematic diagram where we can see the pictures. So
there will be 8 hours, then we proceed with the catheterization, and then
Satin, can you please put
go ahead.
So basically there are three pictures here are shown schematically, like so the one on the left hand of the screen is the dorsal picture, the one at the top of the screen is a sagittal picture, and one on the right side is an axial picture. So we are dealing with something like this, and first thing is that we need to target the area. You can put your pedicle screws first, or you can put them later on also, but it's always easier and better to put the pedicle screws first, because then that time your spinal cord is covered, so inadvertently you will probably not be hurting the spinal cord. Your instrument will kind of not sliding and slipping out of your hand can damage the spinal cord otherwise, if you have done your laminectomy and decompression first. The other advantage of putting the pedicle screws first, that if when you are doing your decompression, you can put a rod on the other side, so that will stabilize the spine to some extent. So your the upper and lower column of the spine with respect to the lesion will not be moving too much, which itself can actually cause further damage to the spinal cord. So I like to target my area, and for that, after minimal exposure and sometime even before that, I can put a needle and target the area if I want to mark my incision. But most of these cases are like two level above and two level below instrumentation, so it's not a microdiscectomy procedure where I have to be very precise. So most of the time I'll be opening up a little bit, and then I'll be holding the pedicle of the vertebra which I need to target. And at this stage I use some kind of forceps to hold the transverse process of the dorsal vertebra or the facet joint of a lumbar vertebra. So I take advantage of this picture throughout the procedure, so because this picture will tell me, I keep this Ellis forceps like perpendicular to the floor. So as compared to this forceps, I'll come to know the relative direction, the supra-inferior direction of all the pedicles which I'm going to instrument. So I wanted to come and take a C-arm shoot to put every pedicle screw. So once the target area is decided, pedicle screws are inserted, and for the patients who have a deficit, I prefer to do a formal laminectomy, though many times we can go unilaterally also and keep the other side of the lamina and the facet joint intact, and including the midline structures. But in this presentation, the pictures I have is with the formal laminectomy procedure. So I do the laminectomy, then so this is whichever area we are doing at that disc level, I've done the laminectomy. It's more of an interlaminar decompression sort of procedure. So you remove all the inferior lamina of the upper vertebra and the superior lamina of the lower vertebra. After that, you come laterally and then you start doing your facetectomy. Now, before you start doing your facetectomy, you have to identify the nerve root, which is just below the pedicle on the side where you are working at. So once you have identified your nerve root, you can remove the pedicle also. So as we are seeing on the opposite side, so the pedicle is kind of seen and the nerve root is running just below it. So this is the site of the pedicle, and then you can with the burr or if the lesion is very soft, you can sometime even with the help of nibbler or disc forceps, you can actually remove this part of the pedicle. Once you remove the pedicle, you can reach the disc and the upper part of the the lower body which is destroyed. So basically most of the time what we see is the periodiscal lesion. So it's the lower part of the upper body and the upper part of the lower body which are affected. So once you remove the pedicle of the lower body, you can actually same time reach for the destroyed part of the lower body and can debride the and reach for a solid base where you can, if required, put a mesh cage. After the pedicle is resected, then you proceed with the vertebral body resection in cases of severe destruction of the vertebral body. So basically what your aim is that you keep on going till the time you reach a reasonably, now you don't have to scrape out every bit of affected tissue, because after starting the AKT, most part of the affected bone will kind of become recalcified and will become strong enough to provide enough stability. But at the same time, you would not like your mesh case to be resting on the very soft part of the tissue. So you remove reasonable amount of bone till the time you reach a if not hard, at least the firm part of the bone, both in the upper as well as lower surface. And once you're done that, sometime you will find like second gush of the pus coming out, which you can save for culture and sensitivity. Whichever tissue comes out, especially the granulation tissue, you will have to collect it and send it for histopathology and culture and sensitivity. Every bit of tissue is important. You have to be very careful how your assistant or sister will collect this tissue, because sometimes they are going to use a gauze piece. And when they will take it out from your, like how they do it for the degenerative cases, once they will take out this tissue and will kind of pull it away with the help of the gauze piece, most of it will remain, kind of will be squeezed out and will remain with the gauze piece also only, and then we'll have hardly any tissue left to be taken, to be sent for the sample. So you have to be very careful that how your assistant or the nurse is collecting this tissue from your operating instrument. Once the vertebral body resection is done, then you are trying to reach that hard surface of the bone, and you have to confirm that your you are through and through. You have to now at this stage feel for the anterior surface of the spinal cord, because that's the main aim of this surgery. Especially most of the time we are doing this surgery for the neural decompression for the patient who come with deficit. So the anterior surface of the spinal canal should be thoroughly decompressed. So you have to be putting some instrument there and kind of feeling for the anterior surface of the spinal cord. Before I put my mesh case, as a general rule, I usually put a 12 mm case. So I put my finger there and then I check whether my finger is, so there is enough space without squeezing the spinal cord laterally to put my cage width wise. Because once it is in, then I can rotate and kind of align it vertically. But the diameter wise, it should be able to go in without pushing the cord unnecessarily. And many times we actually have to cut this mesh case because it's longer than what we need. So one end will definitely have some sharp edges, so you have to kind of prevent those sharp edges from hitting the spinal cord. So it's very important that you, while putting the cage in, before you put the cage in, you have ensured that the available diameter to put the cage is sufficient. I tend to put some bone graft before I put the cage in, anterior to the cage, so that I can achieve good bony fusion. And then I check for the cage, and then I check whether it's going in or not. Most of the time I'm happy with the locally available bone, and then I the same I'll put inside the cage. But in cases of osteoporotic bone or where the locally available bone is not adequate, I don't hesitate to take out the iliac crest bone graft also. So this way the cage will go in vertically in with the diameter occupying the available space. And once it is in, then we rotate it and align it vertically, resting on the upper as well as lower debrided end plates. And this is the kind of final picture you would like to achieve. With most of the time we put four screws above and four below, and the cage resting on whatever firm surface of the bone is available. After the procedure, so at the level of the disease, we have done the interbody fusion. But the other levels where we have done the instrumentation, I tend to fuse those areas also, and my procedure of choice for those areas is that I remove the spinous processes, and then I, with the help of a curved osteotome, I decorticate the outer table of the lamina, and then I kind of just crush it and put it back over there. at the level of surgery also, I put some bone graft laterally also spanning one transfer process to other. So I can achieve some additional fusion in that area. In cases where your entire body is affected and you are not able to put a long case, sometimes you can use an expandable kind of case. Whenever you are using an expandable case, you have to be very, very careful, because whatever graft you put inside an expandable case, that's very minimal. Secondly, you put the graft in the non-expanded stage, and once you expand the case, that graft has lost its continuity. So you have to put a lot of graft before you put the cage in. The cage is just there to provide an immediate stability to the construct. If we are doing a hard lesion surgery, then we
Wait,
do
we
not...
the heart lesion surgery.
Okay, 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 Satyan. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Amit.
Yeah.
So we've had a very good discussion on the technique of doing this posterior surgery. Before we take this further, Uday wanted to show something.
Since Uday is not responding, we'll take this further, go back to our ring. I'd like to ask Dr. Dalvi, sir, you saw Amit's presentation, and he does, he removes the facets from both the sides, he removes the spinous processes in order to get the cage inside. Now, do you think that, don't you think that would be a bit too much? You would be sacrificing the stability a lot. Would you do this differently?
My next talk is on anterior surgery, so I would do it anteriorly, but no, I would do TPD as well. But I do the TPD strictly from one side. I actually don't even remove the midline, because there is no need to remove the midline, and there is definitely no need to remove the opposite side. When you're doing the TPD anyway, you are contravening the natural principles of any kind of surgery. I think it's a the surgery is a complete you know, sort of an insult to any principles of surgery, because you are going completely tangent. But the least you can do is preserve the midline and the opposite side. And one side is more than enough, because you can easily go all the way across to the opposite side to decompress and debride, and you can put your cage from one side. Now, when you have done it by removing from both the sides, and it's not that we don't do. So, I mean, I don't think Amit is doing anything wrong in that way. When we do osteotomies, we do disconnect both the columns. So, that way it's not wrong. The only issue is that at the end of that surgery, you are dependent only and only on the implant. Now, if your implant doesn't work, if you have implant failure, if it cuts out, or if you have infection, you're in deep shit. If you have an infected implant, there is no way you can remove that implant, because you'll have just two floating sort of columns. And that would strongly worry me. So I try to maintain as much natural stability as possible. But of course, Amit's a senior guy. He's been doing it and he's been obviously getting results. So
yeah.
I would say that that's a way of doing it.
Yeah. Dr. Nene, what would you think about the surgery? What is your target? What do you want to do here? Do you really need to get all that body out and put the cage in? Or is it helpful? Or do you think it's for stability wise, it's a good idea?
So in TB, my principle is that of taking out minimum bone, creating a slot adequate to put in a good construction. But I expect the bone to regenerate with the medication. So I go by that middle principle, where in most cases I would just splint and decompress the middle column. But when there's a big cavity in the front, I would reconstruct it just by taking off optimum bone. Unlike a tumor where you do a VCR or a deformity where you do a lot of bone resection, here I'm a bit minimalist.
Okay, great. Uday, go ahead.
Yes, so I take this opportunity to invite you all of you for the first Bombay Spine Society conference, which we are planning this December on the 19th and 20th. And under Dr. Srivastav and whole of the Bombay Spine Society star faculty as well, we'll be inviting some international faculty, and just a virtual conference that we are going to have for the first time for the Bombay Spine Society. So I invite you all for this thing, and please mark the dates. 19th and 20th December 2020. Thank you. Yes, Satyam.
All right. So we'll take this case further ahead. Now, this is this patient underwent surgery elsewhere. Amit, I'd like to ask you, what are your comments on this
surgery. Now, what has happened here?
So do you have like pre-op, post-op, like with what are you asking? So let me just guess that.
If this is what a post-op x-ray is for this patient, mm-hmm. in this patient, they have not done an anterior stabilization. He has, normally we would do an anterior reconstruction along with pedicle screws, two above and two below, two levels above and below. Here he has gone three levels above, three levels below, but anterior reconstruction has not been performed. Do you think this is a good one, or do you think it is acceptable?
So there are few issues with this x-ray, which I see over here. Number one, it's a lumbar spine. So I would like to save as many levels as possible. So in this case, we see a severely destroyed body, but just below that, there is another body which is like maybe partially destroyed. So my first screw probably would have been in that vertebra and one more below that. So the primary surgeon has gone like two more level below that, so probably I would definitely be avoiding that, number one. Uppermost one of the screw is kind of going out laterally, the one on the right side of the screen, but I think that's a different matter. But probably I would have gone two level above, two level below, and below part will be definitely involving that partially destroyed vertebral body and one vertebra below that. That's it. Now, we don't necessarily have to put cages all the time. Many times what I do, I just shove in some bone graft over there. So, and that also works like equally well. I would not be necessarily worrying about this being a junctional area as long as there is enough stability, and then I assume that my AKT is going to work, and then I'm going to achieve a fusion with the bone graft which I'm putting inside that interbody area. Many times actually, to be true, we don't necessarily have to go in there and then put the bone graft also, because bones are already touching with each other, so we can just do a posterior lateral fusion, like a laminar fusion over here.
Okay, great. So you're saying that we can accept this as well, and this may also heal nicely. So basically, TB is a medical disease is what we are saying, and this is just to stabilize while the medicines work. Now, this patient actually was recovering well, but 3 months later, she came back with severe pain again. And now, right now, the neurology has worsened significantly, and now the power is 0/5. So I'll take this further. I thought that maybe now this has collapsed, and that's why this has happened. And so I got the MRI done and saw that this area was okay. It was maybe even looked like maybe it is healing. And when we got the, of course, some of the screws are a little out, they're a little wonky. There is some cutout happening at the lower levels, but it is still holding. But on getting the screening done, we saw that there is the lesion above. Uday?
Yes, so if... So new lesion worsening under treatment, under a hopefully a susceptible Cox, not a resistant Cox, with a gross neurology, which is in front of us. Manish, your take on this?
I was assuming the patient was taking AKT all this while. So this is clearly a failure of treatment. And there is a new lesion. So I will be highly suspicious of MDR. So I hope the primary surgeon had sent all the tests required to detect TB and MDR or any other diagnosis. So I'll change all those tests, make sure they are collected and check what they were, and probably take a decision based on that.
Correct. So I guess it's not done until it's completely done. Agnivesh, any further inputs on this?
No, I would agree with Manish regarding the antitubercular therapy. We need to monitor that, because if the lower one is improving or it has stayed back and there's a new lesion, whether it was missed on the initial MRI, it has progressed or collapsed, or what has happened, we need to consider all of these points as well.
Yes, Satin.
Yeah, so actually this surgeon had not done the biopsy even at this stage, and if it was done, the reports were not available. So now this patient, when came to us again, she's grade 0/5 power now, and so we had to take her up for surgery immediately, and we did the stabilization to about two below with the cage here, We went sent the patient for sent the material for biopsy, and it showed rifampicin resistance. And second line AKT was started by the pulmonologist. So this patient started improving well, but again she came back after 2 weeks with severe back pain and radiculopathy going into the lower limbs, and the rods were tented against the skin. And this is what has happened at this stage. So I'd like to ask Dr. Dalvi here, so what do you think, could this have been avoided in the beginning itself, or is it just something which has just gone bad just because you have not got your biopsy done and the medication was not proper?
Yeah, this patient is fairly unlucky actually, one thing after another. But yes, I think that one of the basic issues is that the disease was not probably working out. And probably she underwent some collapse over there at the lesion, which caused the whole thing. Because some screws are, I think, broken as well. Some have cut out. And the whole construct has actually failed. And tough luck. Well, we have to redo it. You have to redo it.
Dr. Nene, would you have done anything differently as a beginning from construct point of view, or should we not harp on it? It was just...
No. I would have done a biopsy before doing this kind of an operation. And given her the correct medicines, you would have probably gotten away with all. And I'm sure that the upper lesion was also pre-existing. So I would have done a whole spine sequence in the first outing. I don't think it's a brand new lesion, because this lesion is not failing so badly. It's the construct that's failing. And then, as someone rightly pointed out, it's a junctional upper lumbar area where you do a short 360 degree reconstruction if you had to do surgery.
Abhijit, what would you want to do on this patient now?
Now, she needs a revision surgery at this level. The construct has failed. She has a neurological involvement again. I would go again posteriorly. Remove the hardware, go posteriorly, put longer screws or bigger diameter screws. And I would do a transpedicular decompression and fuse that with a cage at that level. Cage or iliac-based bone graft. So what she needs is fusion.
And instrumentation-wise?
Instrumentation-wise, I would go use again the three levels above, three levels below, and use larger diameter screws. If she's osteoporotic, I would use HA screws or augment them with cement. But I think if she's young, I would go ahead with large diameter screws itself and longer screws if possible.
All right. So
I would go to the pelvis for this one. Old is she?
She's 38.
She's very young, but I would still go to the pelvis, because I think she's an unlucky character. Her bones are not good. And she's just got that one alpha S1 disc left behind. So that's going to give trouble later on. So if you're opening otherwise you have to do it again after a few years.
Would you want to just go to the pelvis? Anterior procedure for her, or straight away go to your top?
I'll go to my top now.
All right. So I'd like to invite Dr. Dalvi now to talk about the role of anterior surgery in pod spine. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to talk about anterior surgery. And I'm sure all of you are a bit tired by now, but just stay awake for some time. So surgery in TB, basically you do a debridement, you have to do a decompression, and you have to do a reconstruction. No matter how you do it, these are the things which you have to do. And these things go hand in hand. The decompression and reconstruction goes hand in hand. There is something which my teacher told me, which is a zone concept in TB. There is an anterior zone, which is the zone of disease. And this is used for decompression, debridement, and reconstruction. So all the three major things are really things which you do in the anterior zone. And then there is the posterior zone, where the elements are intact in most of the TPs, right? Most the elements are intact. The posterior elements are usually intact. And you use this for instrumentation. So keeping that principle in mind, that TB is basically an anterior disease, one should say that whatever surgery you do has to access the anterior column or attack the anterior column. Now, if you look historically, they started with laminectomy, which created huge problems because they didn't know what was happening. Patients got much worse. There was posterior fusion by Albion Hibbs, which didn't do anything as well. But the first surgery actually was radical debridement, which was done anteriorly. this turned out to be a bit difficult for some people. So they did what is known as an ALD. And I don't know if any of you know from the ALD era, which was like a semicircular incision and costotransversectomy and going anterior. It was a nice operation in some ways, but not the same as any of these. And finally, now we have come to this era of posterior transpedicular decompression, what Amit has shown us. However, the first successful TB spine surgery was anterior surgery with this landmark paper by Hodgson and Stock, where they did the Hong Kong approach, where they did a radical debridement. They did an anterior approach. They debrided radically and put bone graft. And this worked the best in those days. In fact, they had some of the best results of TB in those days when AKT wasn't all that good. So what are the strategies for decompression? No matter what you do, you need an adequate approach. You need effective decompression and reconstruction of the deficit. And you have to drain the abscess, remove the sequestrae, peel off the granulation tissue, visualize the dura, and excise the internal gibbous, if any. So if you have something like this, at the end of it, you should have something like this, where the cord is falling free and there's nothing in front of the cord. And if you look at a CT, it should be something like this. So since the disease is anterior, you must access the anterior spine. So in cervical is fair enough. Nobody thinks of doing posterior. In thoracic, it would be transthoracic. Lumbar, it would be retroperitoneal. In T2-3, transsternal. L1-2, transdiaphragmatic. And L5-S1, transperitoneal. So in a thoracotomy, you see the abscess directly. You can see the dura. And you can just remove the dura, enter the abscess and enter the vertebrae, enter the defect and decompress the cord. For larger ones, you can do double thoracotomies. For the cervicothoracic junctions, which is hidden behind the surgical, so the surgical cervicothoracic junction is T1-2-3, not C7-T1. And for that, you may need to sort of have a better approach where you need to remove this. But we have modified that approach where we do a T-shaped incision and open only the manubrium, and that is enough to lead us down to T4. So with neck extension, we are really able to go down to T4. What about the thoracolumbar junction? Above T12, you can just do a thoracotomy through the 10th rib. But and below L3, it's a lumbotomy. But at L1, L2 in continuity, you have to do this, a transthoracic, retroperitoneal, transdiaphragmatic approach. And you go through the 10th rib and you peripherally cut the diaphragm and you're right down there. So this sounds huge, but these are lovely approaches. If you're trained in them, you get excellent access and results are good. So like I said, this is what it should look like at the end. And what you need to do is this anterior compression needs to be decompressed and you need to get a graft in there. So that is your operation. That is the standard or the time-tested operation for TB. And the reconstruction has to be a good strut of bone graft from good bone to good bone. And you may even add instrumentation. Instrumentation increases stability and safety and can be used to correct the deformity. But the point is that when you have a defect, it should be well reconstructed. So if you have something like this, so these cases of mine are really very old cases. These are 15 years old cases. You can see this patient not doing well posterior and then anteriorly went in, put in a bone graft. It's another one. So some of these we may think of doing posteriorly today, but those days I was doing them back in front. This is another one where you can see there's continued collapse and it's going down. And instead of doing it posteriorly with cord compression as well, we did a back and front. So did a posterior shorter segment because it's a DL junction and put in a bone graft and an implant from the front as well. This is again at the cervicodorsal junction where we did the posterior instrumentation, but followed it up with an anterior transsternal sort of decompression. You can see the bone graft there. This is done as a transsternal. Okay, so I don't, because we are running short of time. Now this, look at this one. This is a partially healed TB. And there is a sort of a partially healed anterior gibbous. So this is best done anteriorly and you can use anterior implants as well. This with the brace is okay, good enough. Another one, T10 Cox on AKT collapsed, partially healed. You can see the myelomalacia there. And this is because of a hard internal gibbous. You cannot do this posteriorly safely and you can do this anteriorly very well. This is another patient who was operated inappropriately posteriorly. They just did a laminectomy for him. So obviously we had to go from the front and then do a surgery of decompression as well as fixation. And this is one where a transpedicular decompression was done with Hartzell, but the patient came back with disease. As you can see in the CT myelo, there is compression anteriorly and therefore I had to go anteriorly transdiaphragmatic, decompress and put in a bone graft. This is another one which we have done anteriorly and you can see the fusion which has taken place over there. So the advantage of an anterior approach is that it's an excellent and direct decompression. You get good bone graft, a very good reconstruction. You can really debride. You can get all the abscess out. And there is no unnecessarily destabilization. Like I said, my biggest objection to the TPD is that we remove normal tissues, tissues which are giving stability to do your approach. The downsides is it requires great experience. I think most of the modern generation surgeons will sort of hesitate when they see these x-rays, and they have no experience with anterior surgery whatsoever. Luckily, I am in an era where I have plenty of experience with anterior surgery. And my seniors had even better experience because they actually did general surgery. And the complications you have to avoid. I mean, that's the only way, because people used to ask Dr. Lahiri, sir, how do you manage if you damage the aorta? So you used to always say, my friend, you should see to it that you don't damage the aorta. So the point is you should avoid complications. Anterior instrumentation is not as reliable as posterior instrumentation, definitely not for deformity correction. So if you were to do a head-to-head, the anterior technique is unfamiliar to the modern generation of surgeons, whereas the posterior surgery is something which you do day in and day out. The approach is challenging in as much that there are different approaches. Transthoracic, you have to know how to deal with the ribs, pleura. You need to know how to deal with the vessels and, you know, especially at the junctional areas, you need to know how to do it. The potential complications in the anterior are much more because, you know, with the posterior, what complication can you get? But anterior, you can even get a sort of a lymphatic injury, and you can get the weirdest kind of complications which you need to know how to deal with. You know, you have to really look for the ureter and other kinds of things. The learning curve, of course, it needs great training. Anterior surgery is not easy. You cannot look at this presentation and take up a patient anteriorly. And postoperatively, you require some care for the anterior because there is a chest tube. They may go into paralytic ileus and things like that. So it requires care. Whereas the posterior surgery, you can just go home and sleep and nothing will happen to that patient. But the anterior debridement is definitely more effective. The graft and the reconstruction is better. I'm always worried about this cage which we put in. I think we leave it a bit Bhagwan Bharose. When we do this posterior TPD and we put in the cage and graft, we are a bit Bhagwan Bharose. I always feel that this cage can go anywhere, tilt anywhere, anything can happen. It may or may not fuse. You know, we don't know whether it's really holding all that well. The neural decompression also is direct as opposed to indirect. Instrumentation is challenging and not as good. And the blood loss in a good anterior approach is very less compared to a posterior approach. We know about transpedicular decompression. We already had a paper on that. I feel it's a compromise surgery. I still feel it's a compromise surgery. I think you're doing it because you don't want to do anterior. It sacrifices good elements like facets. The instrumentation is much, much longer than what you do with an anterior. And as I said, you are then dependent on the instrumentation. If you're taking away what nature has given for stability, you are then depending only on instrumentation. And the decompression and reconstruction is less than ideal. So then why are we doing it? It is because TB is a forgiving disease and therefore we get away. Simple. That is the answer. TB forgives you. Even if you don't debride, the AKT takes care of it. If you don't decompress, it still goes away. And it fuses. Eventually, it all fuses. So if you have something like this, you can go directly with an anterior approach or like this, which is indirectly through a transpedicular approach. And you decide which is better. So this sort of thing, if you do a TPD, you are going really 5 or 6 levels, means considering above and down. But a similar kind of X-ray or MRI, you can just put in a cage and this patient does equally well with no loss of motion segments through a very smooth, nice anterior approach. So exactly. So do you want the picture on the left? Do you want something like this where so many segments are gone? Or do you want something like this, which will then heal up and be equally good? Thank you. I'm done.
Thank you, sir. So I understand that anterior surgery for TB spine, we were doing a lot of these earlier, but now it's all posterior. Presently, what would your indications be for going anteriorly?
Definitely those where there are partially healed hard bumps, those who already had posterior surgery done, those are the ones where you need to remove an internal gibbous. I think many of them I would go anteriorly. For the softer ones, I would go for these lesions which I feel require, you know, sometimes it's just it just comes to me that why don't I do this one anteriorly, you know, because it's a beautiful surgery and you get a very good result. You're very happy with the amount of segments which you spare and things like that. And sometimes you need a back and front. If you feel that there's a large amount of destruction anteriorly and you're doing posterior and you feel that the cage is too large to go from the back, then it's better to do from the front. I don't know, in spite of success stories, I'm not very happy about this concept of putting a cage from the side and jamming it in and, you know, hoping that everything works.
So, right. For a lumbosacral junction, you find it very difficult sometimes to get away with just a posterior surgery. especially with huge abscess, L5 destroyed, L5 S1 disc gone, then probably would you go venture with an anterior surgery along with a posterior instrumentation? Because I always find it very difficult, especially for the lumbar sacral junctions, I find it very difficult to...
So it would depend, exactly. It would depend on how much destruction, etc. there is. Yes, lumbar sacral junction is another area where you can go. But it's a great way. I mean, it's a great surgery and it's a great way to learn anterior surgery. Like TB has been our teacher. And we've done, those people who are from my era and, Mihir and above would know this, that we used to do lots of anterior surgery in KEM, and that has really taught us to be confident in do spine surgery.
Agreed.
So I'll take this ahead. This coming back to the same patient who had this cutout, the unlucky patient, we went ahead and we did a posterior reconstruction by putting in a heart shield. And she started getting better with the second line AKT and eventually recovered. So the take home message here is that, a stitch in time stays nine. And if this patient would have been, we would have got the biopsy done early, we would have got the, status of MDR early, we could have avoided all these complications for her if the right AKT would have been given. Whenever we do a surgery, the surgery is aimed to do a adequate stabilization and a fusion debridement decompression. But the main thing is the stabilization while the disease is healing. And no amount of surgery can compensate for an inadequate or an improper antitubercular therapy. So MDR is the real threat and we need to be vigilant about it. Before we go on to the talk, Uday, you want to ask anything on MDR?
No, I guess we'll just switch on to the talk because we are running short of time right now.
Well, invite Dr. Agniwesh to talk about MDR on tuberculosis. It's a very important topic and we should all be aware and have a very high index of suspicion on it.
All right. Is my screen visible?
Yes,
Agniwesh. Yes. Okay. So in the interest of time, I will skip the statistics. But we need to understand one thing very well is that one of the main reasons of MDR is because of treatment default or if you're not taking proper dose of AKT. So we need to be very careful in sort of prescribing the AKT as per the body weight of the patient. And we should always do a routine culture sensitivity. And it is a threat which is increasing day by day. This all was brought to light in 2009 by this landmark paper, which was published by the moderators of this session only. And it drew our attention towards a set of patients who had this multi-resistant tuberculosis and the threat which it sort of imposed on us. And there was an urgent need to include drug and culture sensitivity in these patients and probably in all the patients. That is what we meant. So what is the problem with this MDR TB? What are the key factors which differentiate it from a regular TB? One of the problems is that starting an empirical ATD without any biopsy, you see the MRI and you say, "Arey, the TB," and you start giving the medicine. So let's have a look at this paper wherein children were studied less than 15 years and the mean age was 10 years. So before they could be diagnosed, they received an average of 13.6 months of wrong ATT or the first line ATT. After that, it was realized that, these are MDR TBs and we need to switch to these things. So 50% of these patients had spinal deformities by that time. 50% of these patients had multicentric involvement. And of course, the second line AKT is much, much costlier than the first line. So you're giving both the things and increasing the burden in the patients. The second is the delay in diagnosis of an MDR can have serious consequences. Let's have a look at this 36-year-old male who was diagnosed sort of TB and started on empirical ATD. And 3 months down the line, he presents with complete paraplegia. And he went ahead and did the surgery. And we can see that it turned out to be a drug-resistant TB. Probably if a biopsy was done and we could have given him the right AKT, he would not have done that. The MRI at 9 months shows that the patient's cord is adequately decompressed, the disease is subsiding, but he's still not able to walk. So something which could have been prevent it. The other biggest thing is the side effect of the second line drugs. That's why I said it is better to leave it to a specialist like a chest physician, TB specialist, or a physician if you don't have anything. But these are dreaded complications which we need to be well aware about. Let's try to understand these AKT for our understanding. These are divided into five groups. The first line is the first group, then comes injectables. The third is the fluoroquine alone, then are the fourth and fifth group. So these groups are in decreasing order of efficacy. So the group one is the one which has got maximum efficacy, and group five is the one which will be having weakest efficacy. So another paper which sort of tried to look into the side effects of the patients of AKT. So more than one third of the patients have these side effects, and these side effects are very, very sort of distressing. Like gastrointestinal disturbance is a milder one. The psychiatric disorders, the sort of neurological disorders, the dementia, the behavioral change, and all these things which happen, they may sometimes be irreversible, and you don't want to be dealing with that. And when you're dealing with a second line AKT, as a surgeon, we would like to treat and do the surgery and leave the these all side effects for somebody who has a better understanding to manage. The initial paper was again sort of expanded into a 111 case series by our moderators, Dr. Nene, Dr. Pawar. And then in this study, this was a very interesting study which showed us that what are the patterns of resistance what we get. So out of 686 patients, 111 patients had resistance to one or more of the drugs. And among these, 37.8 was smear positive. Now let's have a look that MDR, multi-drug resistance, which means rifampicin and isoniazid, was 78%. XTR was 2.7%. And among all of these, the people who had defaulted, so 82% of the defaulters turned out to be having MDR. And among HIV, all of these patients were having MDR again. So let's try to have a analysis of resistance. If you're looking to give empirically second line, you don't have cultures or something, then in the sort of group one or the primary line, pyrazinamide was the one which had least resistance. Then in the second line drugs, the ethionamide and ofloxacin, one of the two most commonly added drugs to the sort of failing regime, were having very high resistance. The kanamycin and amikacin were intermediate, and the capreomycin and clofazamine, they were having least amount of resistance in the drugs. So the guidelines which we can give based on these sort of treatment or these findings is that we need to be taking these drugs from group one to group five. If you have got two drugs from group one which are sensitive, use those two drugs and then take one from the group two or group three. Then ideally five drugs, including a parenteral drug, needs to be given, and at least 6 months of injectable, if it is sensitive, is preferable. And then you sort of, pyrazinamide is the one which is most favorable empirically, followed by fluoroquinolone. And among fluoroquinolones, moxifloxacin has the least resistance, and ofloxacin, again, which is the commonly added drug, has got a higher resistance than all of these. You need to give high-end doses to avoid, to sort of treat these patients. So among group one, pyrazinamide was the least resistant. Group two, kanamycin was the least resistant. Group three, moxifloxacin was the least resistant. Group four, this pass was had least resistance. It has got GI side effects, so enteric coated pass can be given to avoid these. And ethionamide has got better resistance, but a higher, better sort of tolerance, but higher resistance. Cycloserine can be used, and clofazamine, which we did not find any case of resistance to clofazamine in our sort of thing. So basic principles which we should adhere to is that never add a single drug to a failing regime. You have given a primary line AKT and you see the MRI is not looking good. Okay, let's add a ofloxacin to the regime. So that is something which you never should do. If you're switching, then switch properly, get a culture, get the proper sensitivity done. And if you can start at least four sensitive drugs, that is your best possible shot. These drugs, as compared to primary line AKT, need to be given for a longer duration of 18 to 24 months. And the other question, very important, is that when do we start treatment? When do we stop the treatment? This 2014 WHO came back with a guideline where they agreed that there is no standard chart which we can give where we can say that, okay, we can stop the treatment at this time. they recommended that intensive phase should go on for 8 months. 18 to 24 months is what you look at, and maybe longer if your sort of symptoms findings are not settling, and you may need to modify your drugs based on toxicity, side effects, depending upon how many you have to take off, you need to extend the therapy of the TB. And despite all of our best efforts, the worst problem is the recurrence. Look at this girl, a young girl, 13-year-old girl. In July 2017, she is sort of, after 2 years of second-line drug-proven sensitive AKT for MDR, she has been stopped. And after 1 year, she comes back with pain and significant sort of weakness in the leg. And this is her MRI, which just shows worsening after 1 year. In November, we sort of starts healing and regressing because of the second line ATT. But again, we don't know when to stop and when to get off this second line drug. The last question is, the early surgery better? Is it better to operate these patients, take out the pus and all? Is it better? So a very recent paper published in 2020 from Ganga Hospital, it says that currently the indications of surgery, there is no consensus that they sort of should be operated early. The indications sort of are considered same as a non-resistant spinal TB cases. There's no evidence that you should operate early on these MDR TB patients unless they have indication. So to conclude, MDR TB of a spine is a reality and we need to be aware about it. Watch out for the presence of XDR, because if that is there, then you need to be very, very careful with giving drugs. Do routine culture sensitivity testing of all TB patients. Aggressive drug therapy and monitoring is needed. Get somebody who knows this better rather than take all the onus on you, and follow guidelines to create individual regimes. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Agnivesh. That was apt ending for the talk. I guess if one point we want to hammer home is, please do get testing for all your patients, a microbiological testing for all your patients. Make an attempt. You cannot hide under that garb that I didn't have access. Please try to develop a rapport with your microbiologist, your interventional radiologist or radiologist. Or if you do the biopsy, make sure you make a genuine attempt to get a culture sensitivity of these patients. Over to you, Satin.
So thank you, Agni. Now we've had a very good discussion on this on pot spine here. There is so much that we can discuss. There are so many more facets and so many more things to this that we can go on discussing, and it can go on for many more hours. But we'd like to hammer home a few take-home messages here, which we have discussed here. This is the final verdict. Number one is that a biopsy is a must. You need to get a biopsy done before starting treatment for these patients. The second thing is, when you follow up these patients, you need to follow them up with clinically as well as radiologically, and you need to have a good clinico-radiological correlation. Whenever there is something going wrong, it's not matching clinically or radiologically, have a high index of suspicion, and you need to think about MDR early. MRI response takes time. MRI is number one, it is not the only criteria. Number two, it takes time. You do not get a good improvement immediately. But if you don't start getting improvement in about 4 to 6 months, then you must again start thinking, okay, maybe is this MDR or maybe she's a late responder. You need to follow these patients more carefully. The antitubercular therapy, as we all discussed, ideally should be given by the pulmonologist so that these patients can be monitored properly. It should be weight adjusted. At least if you are giving it, at least give it weight adjusted. But whatever problems they may get, it needs to be monitored. And so the pulmonologist needs to be involved right from the beginning. And antitubercular therapy, nowadays we are thinking about giving it for 6 to 12 months. However, this is not an absolute guideline, and the treatment is based on the response to therapy. So depending on how the patient responds, you may have to give it a less or quick, or take it for a longer period depending on their response. Whenever surgery is indicated, you need to do a proper stabilization, and only a surgery cannot be cannot take care of an improper medical management. So a proper medical management along with your surgery is the ideal thing which you need to do. And when you do your surgery, do the entire job. You need to stabilize them well. You need to do a proper debridement and a decompression as well. always have a high index of suspicion for MDR. We are seeing more and more of these MDRs. And as Agnive said, avoid adding these drugs unscientifically. Just, you know, add one drug here and there to improve response. It is not going to happen. You're only going to worsen this by adding more and more of MDR. So I want to thank all our panelists. I thank you, Dr. Dalvi. Thank you, Dr. Nene, Dr. Manish, Dr. Abhivesh, Abhijit, Dr. Amit Sharma, Dr. Kundnani, Dr. Mihir Bapat. Thank you all for being here. And thank you for helping us out. Thank you to Bombay Spine Society. We are all Bombay Spine Society. But thank you to Dr. Srivastava, who is our president, who blessed us in the beginning. Thank you, Dr. Bapat. He was here. He helped to fill in when Dr. Srivastava was not available. And I thank our Intas too for sponsoring this program and helping us to get more information on pot spine, on TB spine out to our fellow doctors and surgeons. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. On behalf of Intas, I would like to thank Bombay Spine Society for giving us this special opportunity to be associated with regard to this spinal tuberculosis. The final verdict is all out now. In the first session, we had osteoporosis. In the second, we had spinal tuberculosis. And maybe third one, we would probably left for design to when we can have that third verdict, final verdict on which topic as well. It's been a long journey for us with osteoporosis, if not with tuberculosis. And what is common in both of them are they are equally shattering as far as patient lives are concerned. And we are trying to probably improve the quality of life of osteoporotic patients through our drugs, which we are revolutionizing the treatment of osteoporosis through Terifrac. And the one gray area still in osteoporosis is the monitoring. And I would like to share with you that based upon IOF guidelines for anabolic therapy, bone formative agents does tend to provide more authentic results and more tangible results than the DEXA. So for all your patients, we do a baseline P1NP free of cost. And then after 6 months, we do another for your monitoring purpose. We made our treatment basket more comprehensive by launching our world's first biosimilar denosumab also, which is for your benefit of your patients by the brand name Olimab. And we have in these pandemic times, just to help your patients, we have reduced down the cost as well of teriparatide. If you remember, it was earlier costing around, say, a decade before 20,000. But now it's just costing 3,000 rupees per month, available on a pack of six for your patients as well. So thank you very much for the wonderful opportunity for BSS, all the presenters, moderators, and also the Bombay Spine Society Secretary, Dr. Vishal and Dr. Srivastava sir, for giving this opportunity. And we look forward for continued support and patronage for our osteoporotic drugs as well. And I wish you all a very happy festive season ahead and a wonderful and a very happy Diwali wishes for you and your family. Be safe and be healthy. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Javed. Thank you.
Thanks for that.
Thanks, Atin.